standing by.
Yes, and another warm welcome and good morning. I'm Steph Winterboer. Today we have got Dave on camera, and that over my shoulder is probably the largest herd of wildebeest in the Sabi Sands. It's not a very common sight to see large groups of wildebeest together in one spot, but it seems like the wind and the overcast weather here over the last couple of days has managed to gather these animals here. I've no doubt because of the little bit of rain that we received about 2 weeks ago, we've had a flush of green grass over Juma Private Game Reserve and Arethusa and Cheetah Plains, this northern Sabi Sands, rather than the south of the Sabi Sands or into the Timbavati a little bit further away from here. Haven't seen any grass there yet. And they must have spent the night on these plains. Wildebeest, just like impala, will gather on large open clearings like this so that they can see predators a little bit easier. Even though the moon is pretty full, I think we're only a day or two away from a full moon, it would have had very little light last night. The cloud cover is very, very thick. Temperature at the moment in the mid-50s, degrees Fahrenheit that is, and in the low teens, sort of mid to low teens at the moment. So it's quite chilly. As you can see, I've got a jersey on. The wind is also blowing a lot in actual way. Now, let's see if we can get a little bit closer to those wildebeest. I don't want to bother them and get them to run away, but it's also nice to see at what point they'll choose to run away from us, or at least to move away from us. I don't think they're going to go far. We're obviously not wanting to scare them at all. We're just wanting to sort of bypass them. We want to try and keep the wind into our face this morning. It's coming out of the south. And one of these observations that I made with James while we were unpacking his tent yesterday was the fact that for the last couple of weeks, it seems as if the wind blowing out of the south always brings clouds and the wind blowing out of the north always clears them up. And that's a pretty weird thing. I've never really noticed that before, to be quite honest. We do get most of our rain coming from the south. Although our really, really big storms do come from the north. So it's, I don't know what's happening. Now, we're now walking sideways to these wildebeest. We're not walking directly at them. And because I'm not looking at them, they're not getting nervous. And you can actually see while I'm still not going to turn to them, because as soon as I straighten my body to them, it almost looks as if we are approaching them. And wildebeest don't enjoy that. Just like giraffe, just like zebra, if you look like you're walking past them, they don't mind you at all. And you can see them just standing there. Take a quick screen grab. You're unlikely to see a group of wildebeest this large easily again. The rains are threatening and are not far off. And as soon as the grass in the Sabi Sand and in the adjacent Kruger National Park starts to flourish, these wildebeest will disappear again, coming back to these clearings to calve in about December. Not the same wildebeest as we saw in the Mara a couple of, well now it was probably a month or so back. Those were white-throated gnu or white-throated wildebeest. They had a flowing white beard. They were also slightly smaller. These wildebeest are called brindled gnu. And they are a little bit larger, but you can also see that they don't have that white beard underneath their chin. These wildebeest, although capable of moving massive distances, also don't migrate as far or as widespread as the white-throated cousins of theirs up in Kenya and Tanzania. And don't forget, you can send through questions via email at questions@wildearth.tv or using the hashtag Safari Live, and it's interactive. I have you in my ear right here. We can talk to you, basically answer some questions, send through comments as well. They don't necessarily have to be some questions. You're welcome to just send some comments, ask me about the weather, what are we doing, how much hair I've got on my head, whatever you feel like asking at that moment. We'll see what we can get through, and yeah, have a nice conversation, for lack of a better word. All right, they're moving off down the slope over there. I don't want to push them into the thick bush before they're ready, so I think let's carry on with our walk over here, see what else we can find today. We do have Taylor and James knocking about. They will get ready in the next couple of minutes or so, and I'm sure we'll be saying hello. We've got no real plan today between the three of us, to be honest with you. Yesterday was a bizarre day in terms of animal interactions, and I think it's shaken everybody up a little bit. We had a couple of close calls around the camp yesterday with animals. Noticeably, I think it was buffalo twice, although I think it's the same buffalo, and an elephant. They were very close to camp yesterday. And, you know, as David was saying this morning, it's just one of these things that sort of ground you to the fact that we are in a wilderness area. We are in an area that wild animals, and in particular dangerous wild animals, occur. And it's always good to have these, luckily not fatal or in any way an accident, but it's always good to have these moments that sort of ground you into this. I quite enjoy it, you know. Anyway, we're going to send you over to James. He's ready to say hello to you. We're going to carry on with our walk over quarantine. Catch up with you later.
Good morning, everybody. It is marvelous to be with you here on this, fairly grey and blustery morning. For those of you who do not know, my name is James Hendry, and Wim Doornbraak is on camera. Wim has grown, I think, because his pants are slightly too short for him. Anyway, they were probably free issue, and that is why he's wearing them. Were they free? They were on a bargain, I see. Good. We had a few issues with our communications this morning, so I've got a very beautiful luminous green earpiece. Very nice. That is so that I might hear the director, and the director, of course, is Kirsten McLennan-Smith, and we need to hear your questions via her into my ear, and so it is very important that even though I look ridiculous, I can hear you. Twitter, hashtag Safari Live, questions at wildearth.tv if you're on the email. Our plan this morning is to head due east to where Kurula, the great queen, was yesterday, perched upon a marula tree that had fallen over, and underneath that was a very large impala. Hopefully she and the cubs will be there. Okay, shall we get going? Let's get going. Taylor McCurdy is still trying to get going. She can hear Kirsten, but Kirsten cannot hear her. Right, on we go. Someone is talking. Oh yes, it's the game drive. Here we go. Right. I'm okay now, everybody. Fear not. I feel like this is something I should have told you. What did I need to tell you? Oh yes, it's about 17 degrees apparently, 64 degrees Fahrenheit odd. No, it's not. 62, 17, that's right. Sorry, losing my mind, thousands of things going on in my ear. It feels much colder than that actually, and I think that's because there's a little bit of wind coming through. We'll see if it brings any rain. This kind of cloud doesn't often, I'm afraid. But we might get the odd spatter as the day progresses. And apparently rain is forecast for tomorrow or the next day. Of course, rain was forecast much last year as well, and we saw what happened there. Now, also interestingly, I saw a video yesterday of a lion being attacked by some hyenas. Now that, well, it's entertaining in itself, but what is important that it is that it was shot at Londolozi, which is 7 kilometers from where we're sitting now. Now, many of you will remember what this clearing looked like 2 weeks ago. There wasn't a blade of grass on it. It was just a kind of barren grey landscape with the odd stump on it. That's still what it looks like south of the river. And that's why we're seeing so many buffalo up here. We're seeing, well, a relatively large number of those things that can't be mentioned. And I think that the lack of rain down there has really changed the dynamics. And it's not water they're looking for now, the animals. There's plenty of water around. Well, I mean, there's some standing water. There's enough standing water. It's grazing and browse that all the animals have come up to see. That's why the Nkuhumas are still knocking about here, murdering buffalo willy-nilly, as it were. And so it's rather good time for us in the north of the Sabi Sand. Brent's brother, who works down at Sabi Sabi, which is even further south, that is, he says, is like a desert as well. They've had almost no rain. Now let's just go down here. There is a hippopotamus in the Juma Pan. I'm not going to go there because we can't get close to the camp unless they're out of camp, and I'm not sure they aren't yet. So if you want to see a hippopotamus, good idea to go to the dam cam and have a quick look. It won't be particularly entertaining. He seems to be well asleep. Apparently the dam cam is observing me go across the wall. Hello everybody, wave him. There we are, that's VM waving everybody. Right, there were also some Impala alarm calls around here recently. I'm just going to switch off and have a listen. Although all I can hear at the moment is the fairly driving wind. Well, driving wind is relative. So there's a very strong wind blowing, and it's coming from the southwest unusually. That's over there. Normally it comes from the southeast over there when there's a front like this. I'm not sure what kind of an omen that is. But there are no Impala alarm calling. There's one lonely scrub robin going. And that's it. So let's go and find a leopard, Vim. What do you say? Yes, Vim would like to see a leopard, everybody. Taylor's going to head towards the Inkahumas when eventually she finds a microphone that works. She's going to drive slowly along the banks of the drainage here. Mainly because of those alarm calls that were around here earlier today. I don't think there were any updates from the dam cam last night. Good. And when Taylor does get going, I would ask you to ask her a question about her experience with the buffalo yesterday. You must ask Taylor about that when she eventually gets mobile. She'll have quite a story for you. Craig, you're in Florida and you're wondering if I like my job as much as I seem to like my job. Well, Craig, that's quite an interesting question, and I'm tempted, of course, because I have a naturally sarcastic manner, to answer flippantly, but I'm not going to do that, because it's a really nice question. There are some Impala, and while we look at them, I will tell you that it is possible, of course, to act every so often when you're having a bit of a tough day, or you've had a fight with a lady, and you feel not so good, and then it's, you know, then sometimes perhaps you do need to do a little bit of acting, but you cannot do the job that we do here unless you enjoy it. Because you are in front of the screen, in front of a very large audience who will pick up on inauthenticity very quickly indeed. So, yes, I do enjoy my job as much as I seem to. It really is the most wonderful bush job. It's varied. There's a huge audience of people asking interesting questions. I far prefer to the sort of standard issue guiding that I began my working life in the bush with, and I think all of us do. Certainly Taylor and I had a discussion about it on our way in here. Brent and Jamie, the same sort of thing. So I think we all probably enjoy it as much as we seem to be. And it is, like I say, it's very difficult to be inauthentic for this length of time. Now, oh, there's a little mixed herd here, VMP. No, Now, everybody, I'm sorry, I may be sounding like a robot in FC, which is the final control. I may be sounding like a robot into your home, I'm not sure. But what that means is that we have to reboot the TriCaster, which means, well, you don't need to understand that. All it means is we're going to go to a tech loop for about 10 minutes. Sorry about that. See you just now. We're back. Sorry about that brief technical glitch. We're heading now. I'm not sure what the story is with Taylor just yet, but we'll find out shortly. And all around, some lovely smells, a little bit of, I suppose, some petrichor-ish type smells, with a little bit of moisture that's touched the earth. But there are also smells of flowers. It's very subtle, it's not strong. And I'm not sure exactly which kind of flowers around here. We'll see if we can find some. It really is a very flat, light day. Anyway, let's see what happens. Hopefully some predators will make up for the lack of light. Taylor McCurdy is up and running. Let's go and find out where she's going this morning.
Good morning, everyone. It seems as though I keep catching you on these very cloudy and overcast days. But as you know, my name is Taylor, and on camera with me, we've got Jandre. There he is. Now, my plan today, well, I'm really keen to find the Nkuhumas because I haven't seen them, and I know that James got a glimpse of them yesterday before Rusty had to be raced off to the emergency room. Rusty's doing fine, just in case you were worried and couldn't sleep last night. She is well. Now, Herbert, who's out on a walk with Steph, said that he had heard some impala alarm calling here on Ingwe Alley. So we're just taking a slow little drive along here just to see if we can perhaps see anything. Though we know with impala, though, it could also be something like a hyena that they were alarming for, even a serval or something, a smaller cat. And I think I see some vultures up ahead, which we're going to try and get closer to. Perhaps maybe this is where the lions had that buffalo kill. Oh yes, I forgot to mention the lions killed a buffalo yesterday. And during the day, I think we all missed it, unfortunately, around lunchtime, maybe just after lunch. There's been lots of buffalo around. and they managed to take down a buffalo. I couldn't tell you the sex of the buffalo, unfortunately. See, there's some vultures in there. Let's have a quick look at them. Now, so we've got these white-backed vultures. There's two of them perched up over there. Now, I'm not sure if that's because the lion kill was there yesterday. Perhaps maybe they just were roosting for the evening, and they're going to wait for the clouds to hopefully clear and the day to warm up, and then they'll be able to catch those thermals and head up into the sky. Now, good morning, Anna Marie. And you said that you think we're going to see lots of lions. I have a very good feeling too, but let's carry on a little bit further ahead, and then we'll see what's around the next corner. It's quite nice that we've already started our drive with some vultures. They're quite exciting. They're pretty amazing birds. Now, let's have a... let me just drive extra slowly. So yesterday, let me carry on with my story because I keep getting distracted. It seems as though I think there were three lionesses, and I don't think it was all of the cubs. I think it was only some of the cubs that were on this buffalo kill, which they killed sort of just after lunchtime, and they were eating it. So I'm sure they're still going to be in the same position. It sounds like they were on Wahlberg's Road, so we're going to make our way there slowly, and just as we check here and see what the vultures are perhaps looking at anything, but it doesn't seem like it. They just look very cold and miserable again this morning. Look at them, they don't look particularly happy. Are you full? No, their crops don't look very full. And I'm just scanning down on the ground. It doesn't look like there's any lions or leopards nearby. And I did eat carrots for dinner last night, so my eyes should be working very, very well. No, there's nothing here. So I think our next move is to actually head around and head to Wahlberg's Road and then find those lions. I'm going to have a quick chat with Rexon, because I know that Rex was on his way to try and relocate on those lions. Let's see. Rex Taylor. Let's see what he's, if he's managed. Morning, Rex. I'm wonderful. Thank you. Did you relocate on the lions? Let's see. Negative. Can you give me that lock? Just trying to find out where exactly they are. I'm on Ingwe Alley. Oh, hang on. Okay, very interesting. Okay, copy, thanks. Right, so got some interesting news. So we need to go back towards where Jamie and Brent stay. Oh. Sorry, I'm having a bit of interesting communication. I've got people talking over me. Okay, Kirsty, I couldn't quite hear what you were saying. So what we're actually going to do is Rex has managed to find the lions. And that's what we're going to do. And while I do that and find these lions, let's go back to Steph and see how his little bumble is going.
We've got some elephant very, very close to where we are. I think there's... this dung is still, like, I don't know, it's still so warm. It feels like the elephant's been here just now. It's literally body temperature. And then this urine mark, have a look at that. You can scrape the sand. It's all the moisture still lying on top of the sand, not underneath. So this is no more than a few minutes old, if that even. So I'm fully expecting there to be an elephant somewhere around here. We are in Philemon's Dip, and there is water in this drainage line, but more than that, there's actually food. And we were just talking about why is it that October seems to be this month that is so frantic with elephant in particular. And I think it's because there's a lot of vegetation that is, it is concentrated in these small isolated spots, or these little islands. Camps are one, these drainage lines are another, and then you've got water, of course, which is a draw point or a magnet for these animals. They can't move too far away from permanent water. They've got to stick to these foody areas. And of course, where it's nice to walk is on the shaded parts of these drainage lines, or the big trees. So I've no doubt that there's an elephant here somewhere. It's just a question of trying to avoid him and seeing where he is before he sees where we are. One of the tricks we do is, of course, keeping the wind in our face. And as we get up onto this plateau, we're going to be able to see a little bit better as to what's here. So let's carry on going. This is, of course, the Philemon's Dip pump house. Many of which of you will remember the fact that this was once run by a diesel engine and made the most unbelievable clatter. Now, thanks to modern technology, it's run by a solar pump, and so it doesn't make a single noise at all. This will grab you. So sneaking up around the side of it, I'm using it as a bit of cover so that we can see what's around here. Well, I can say that there's nothing in the immediate vicinity, which is obviously a good thing for us. But you never can tell with these sort of things. Now, what's our plan for today? I'd like to go and walk to Treehouse. I want to go see what those seeps are doing in Treehouse. There's a big well that the elephants have dug there. I think it'll be nice to go and see how full of water that is. I'm going to send you over to James. We're going to carry on to Treehouse.
There's a batelier, everybody, and as everybody knows, a batelier likes to eat scavenged meat. And in the case of scavenged meat, well, it has a ready killer in this particular vicinity, just over there, the Queen. Good morning, Mom. In the same tree she was yesterday, but she is not alone, is she, Viem? Oh, no. She's got a little one eating at the carcass, and I don't know which one that is. Now, these leopards are inside Torchwood. Oh, I keep saying to you, same place as yesterday. But of course, you weren't on drive with us yesterday afternoon. So they were found here yesterday on drive, and they are slightly in Torchwood. We can go a little bit in there, and so we're going to do that. And we'll just see if the other baby's also around. I wonder if she isn't perhaps around Mum. And she killed a male impala here yesterday, sometime probably during the morning. Hello, Marinda. I've missed your question slightly, I'm afraid. Let's look at Karula there. First of all, you wanted to know what does her name mean and how many litters has she had. She's had, so far, I think she's raised 4 litters to success. Is it 4? Yes, this is the 5th. That's correct. And I could, if I had my wits about you, give you all the names, but it's basically been 2 cubs every time, and the most obvious ones, or the most commonly seen ones, are 2 females called Tandy and Shadow. They're still around here. They're 9. She is now 12, of course, and her name, Karula, means peace in the local language, which is Xitsonga or Shangan. You can use those 2 words interchangeably in this area. So it's Karula, and that means peace. And there she is. You can see she's being very peaceful indeed. Now, what I'm going to do is scan the general vicinity with my binoculars and see if I can't see if there's another cub lurking around here somewhere. I can't believe how big these cubs have got. They were born on the 2nd of February this year, which makes them 8 months old. Is that right? I think my maths is correct. Just over 8 months. They're nearly 9, hey? Nearly 9 months old. Now, it's not impossible for a female to go independent at 8 months. Don't think that's going to happen here. I think that's the little male, I think, from his eyes. Now, for those of you who haven't been with us and watching these gorgeous little things growing up, the female, Shongile, has got browner eyes than her brother. She's also got what I like to refer to as the Cindy Crawford sort of beauty spot on her right-hand side, on our left-hand side. If you look at her, that's just underneath her nose. And the male, Hosanna, which means little chief, is sort of paler-eyed. There we go. Yeah, that's the male. He's spotted two animals walking behind us. Not sure what they are. And you can see they're consistently very aware of what's going on around them. The other little cub will be around here somewhere, and I think it's just that I haven't spotted her yet. Isn't he lovely? Does everyone agree that that's the male? For those of you who've been watching for a while, and Shongile, sorry, just quickly, Shongile means beauty or beautiful one. So there's the queen. Let's have another look at her while I scan the vicinity for the other little cub. Often they don't eat together, and often the other cub will be around mum. So let's see if that's the case here. Oh yes, I can see her. There, stop. Can you see the other foot there dangling? There we go. There's the other little one. It was in plain view. How cool is that? We'll move in a little while to go and have a look, see the other one. That is the most fantastic leopard shot, isn't it? I might have to take a rank average photograph. Oh, thank you, Judy H. You found another identifying marker for Hosanna, the male. You say this is definitely him, and you know that because he's got a nick also out of his left ear. I hadn't noticed that. Now, I was told this was an adult male impala. I can't see any horns, but I think... Ooh, what's coming up here? Look at his fat little belly there. He's going. I think he may have had enough to eat. Oh, he's a gorgeous little fellow, isn't he? Look how big he's got. He's almost the same size as his mum. Not quite yet. But almost. We will move shortly, everyone, to go and have a look. I just want to see what happens, because it's quite possible that once he goes into the tree, one of the others will come out. Oh, that's nice. Isn't that sweet? How awesome is that? That is so cool. A tree, a very little tree, full of leopards. I think that's just wonderful stuff. They are very comfortable indeed. And he's playing with a little bit of tree. Now the little female, let's just see if she doesn't decide that she's going to come out. And somebody said, or Jerry, I think, who's our producer, said to me quite interestingly, she said, I was away for a little while, and Karula's been very playful with these youngsters. And she said, well, maybe she's become so playful with them because she knows they're about to leave home. I thought that was quite a nice explanation. I don't think it's true by any stretch, but I think it's quite nice that apparently mum has become a lot more playful with the little youngsters of late. And why that should be the case, I'm not sure. Gosh, that's wonderful. Isn't that a beautiful picture? Playing with mum's tail. There might be another view from the other side there. I think this is such a great view. What do you think, Vim? I think it's a pretty good view. But we'll go and have a look from the other side shortly. But Mum, very patient. She's kind of trying to have a snooze. And he's got a belly full of food. And it's chilly this morning, which means he's feeling extremely playful. Hello, Debbie in Vancouver. You've noticed what I have noticed, and I noticed, I think, fairly early on, is that these cubs don't seem to feed together. They also, there's a little, there, they're having a little play now. Debbie, I think it's because they're leopards that they don't feed together. That is how things will persist for their lives, you know, when they're adults. And for me, it's been very noticeable how little they've wanted to do with each other compared with the lions. They're not by any stretch antagonistic towards each other, but they're not as social as lions are going to be, and so they do feed separately, and they have since they were very young. I could be wrong here, but I can't remember actually seeing them both feeding on a carcass at the same time. How cool is that? That is just wonderful. Mum watching on. And they seem to have interestingly become more playful the older they've got, which I think is quite interesting. VMP, I think we should go and move around a little bit and see if we can't get a slightly better view. They will probably be completely... I'll probably move by the time we get there. Anyway, let's go and have a look. We don't really know where to look at the moment. We've got 8 lion cubs to show you now.
So it was quite easy to find where these buffalo were, thanks to Rex, who helpfully guided me into the sighting. And we've come across them now. Obviously, I didn't see the kill. I wasn't in the sighting yesterday when Jamie found the lions on the kill. So I can't tell you too much, but by the looks of it, it looked like a very young buffalo and there's not really anything left anymore. I can only see 3 adult lionesses here, and then I can see 6 cubs. So we're just missing 2 females and 2 of the cubs. And I couldn't tell you who's who because it looks like they've all grown up so much. They're almost all the same size now. I don't think the teddies are quite looking like teddies anymore, so I can't wait to see them. I think this could even be one of them. Hello, little one. Now you can see those fat bellies. They've had a good feed, and they're all playing around with each other, which is fantastic. We've got you just at the right moment. Look at them. They've all got bounces of energy. There we go. Oh, down, taken down. And we know how important this behavior is, as cute and sweet and as funny as it is. This is what they're going to be doing one day, is racing around and jumping onto the backs of buffalo, hopefully, like their mothers do so well. But for now, they've just got to practice and play with each other. And you'll see them now that they're all huddled around the carcass, how they sort of back off a distance and then they race over and jump on it as if they were pretending to take down that buffalo. It's basically just a little snack for them. Yes, it would be nice if you went inside into that little cavity, but they're very clean. Normally after we see the Nkumas, especially the little ones, after they've devoured a buffalo, they usually match this color of the soil. They're normally quite black with all the blood and the feces. There you go, one's going back to mom, and the others have sort of said, no, we don't need our parents anymore. We're going to fight and pull on this carcass. Now, their teeth aren't quite strong enough to do sort of any damage just yet. You'll see them chewing on the skin. And I don't think the little bristles on their tongues are as hard as what they should be. So I'm sure they waited for mom to open up that carcass before they could actually eat anything. Normally when they do kill something, you'll see them chewing on an ear or chewing on a bit of hide. But I don't think that carnassial share works too well either just yet. And these are all things that they're going to have to just wait until they're a little bit older to have a better sort of grip of. But they'll keep trying and practicing is good. And I hope you can hear all the wonderful noises. Oh, okay, well, we're going to sit here with the lions for a little bit because they're being fantastic. And while we do that, let's go back and just see how Karula and her two little ones are doing.
Well, there's the mum. She's just come down the tree, everybody. And little Shongile is now playing with her food. Well, that's Hosana. He's sitting underneath the tree. But I'm just watching the little female there. There, can you see? She's got four spots there on her right-hand side, our left, and three on this side. And the fourth spot is the one just underneath, or just above the line there. And that's her little beauty spot. And you can see her eyes, they've changed color, you know. They're not quite as brown as they were. So great. Now, this is a question, Yankee Girl, that has been asked a few times, and I'm not really sure of the answer exactly. You say, if the queen is in her teens, is this possibly her last litter? It is possibly her last litter, but I think she's probably got another one in her. So this lot will probably disappear. Or she's going to go back up the tree. Maybe look at her stalking the little one. She's 12. She's going to be 13 in March next year, if I'm correct. Is that right? VM, have I lost my mind? She was born in 2004. Yeah, so she's 12 now. She will be 13 next year. I was slightly confused for a second there. And that means that these ones will go independent when she is 13. So she could have another litter of cubs either while she's, well, probably when she's just about 14. And that's possible. By then she will be old. So she maybe has one more litter in her. Especially if these two look like they're going to be raised to independence. So I think that she might have one more litter in her, Yankee Girl. And it'll be very interesting to see how the territorial shift occurs when she does eventually shake off this mortal coil. I mean, she could go to 18. I think her mother made it almost to 18 years old. Oh, that's a wonderful shot. Isn't that cool? I think that's just wonderful. Oh, and she's gone straight up and I didn't even see her go. Hello, Cindy. A good question from you about whether or if one of us had climbed a tree and they were around that tree and they climbed it. Would they be able to smell us? Yes, I think they would, absolutely. I mean, I have been walking with elephants and rhino at various stages, and I don't think they have noses quite as sensitive as the cats, and they absolutely can smell where we've just walked. So I imagine if you were to be sort of flinging yourself about in a tree, that these leopards would figure that out very quickly indeed. So I'm pretty sure, yes, they would smell it. Well, let's see what he does, if he decides to go up the tree or not. We'll just smell where his mother's been. He's behaving like a little teddy bear. Well, not a little teddy bear, like a small sort of bear cub. He's also, you see him little, that little grimace he gave there. That is a Flemin grimace. He's having a smell as to exactly what he's interpreting his mother's scent. All right, we're going to stay right here, everybody. We don't have to leave anytime soon. So we'll stay here. Let's head back across the lions and see what they're up to.
So the lions are now on the move. Sorry, I've got a bit of a squeak. I'm just trying to roll forward so you can have a look here. It seems like another lioness is actually joined. It was quite a bit of commotion and we saw this. We actually heard the cubs sort of talking, sort of row, row. And then we all looked up and we looked around, and then just about 40 or 50 meters away from the rest of the pride, another lioness. And of course, all the cubs are now racing towards where the females have got up to. So I'm quite excited to see where she takes us. So we're still missing one lioness though. And of course, the Birmingham that normally tails with them. Now you see they've disappeared. Now this female seems to be going back, but the other girl has come through as well. I don't think they're going to be too worried about their carcass. Sorry, I'm just listening. Listen. Can you all hear that? I'm going to go forward. Okay, fantastic. What I'm going to do is I think whoever's trying to talk down below us, when I say talk, I'm talking about the lion. Someone sounds like he's doing a very half-hearted roar. Listen, turn that volume right up. Oh, everyone's very excited. I think maybe they've been separated for a few days and this is perhaps why they're so excited. Oh, wow, look at them. Have you ever... No, that's not a run that's running away. This little cub is jumping for joy. Yeah. Everyone's coming. Even the female lionesses are walking at a really quite a quick pace. They're all contact calling. They're all talking to each other now, trying to regroup. We know how social the cats are. Isn't this just incredible? Here comes the other lioness. Off she goes. Yeah, moving at a fairly quick pace. Still all talking to each other. Here's one of the mothers. Right, I think what we're going to do now is we're also going to get going. I want to try and get ahead of them. Right. And we just need to make our way around and through all the thick vegetation. But we can do it. Isn't this amazing? Now, I know a few of you were wondering about my buffalo encounter yesterday. That was interesting. And I will definitely get to telling you about my encounter, but we'll just try and keep up with the Nkuhumas for a little bit and see where they're heading to and try and get a good spot, and then I will tell you about my story. Looks like I go a little bit further forward. You can see them here. The others are quite far ahead of us, so we need to try and keep up with them. Let me have a little look. Now they are moving into some very, very thick vegetation. It's quite exciting. They're all chatting away quite nicely, so we'll quickly listen. See if we can get one more sort of sound of them calling. It's really beautiful. You see them. Female voices aren't as deep as the males. It's quite actually easy to tell the difference between the sounds of the males and females, especially with a roar or these contact calling. Females sort of much high-pitched voices compared to the boys. And the girl is just staring back. Perhaps we've left one female behind, and that's why she keeps turning back and looking over her shoulder. She looks very concerned, sort of quite worried. They were saying, come with us, we're leaving. There we go. And I can't tell you, even something small, like that contact call, still makes the bottom of the vehicle rumble. I can feel almost that vibration through my feet. It's just amazing how powerful those resonating chambers are in the back of their throats. Let's see, I think a little greeting ceremony here. Here we go. Very typical to rub heads like that. Isn't this lovely? Hello, guys. So I'm confused as to what's going on because all the cubs are coming back this way now. And the other, I'm going to just duck. There we go. Look at that, all the little tanned creatures coming amongst all the tripods. That was not nice. That was a surprise attack, well planned. Like I said, we're still hearing the contact calling coming from where the cubs have just come from. I'm going to sit quietly though for the next few moments, just so you can enjoy. Sorry everyone, I'm hearing Kirsty this morning. How exciting is this? Cubs seem to have settled down a little bit now. I think that sugar rush is wearing off. You see this all the time with young children, how one moment they're bouncing from wall to wall to wall, and then all of a sudden they're exhausted and they need a quick nap, but then they'll be back again. And there's a lot of bouncing back and forward, calling sort of facing south and then calling and facing north. So that other lioness has gone off now, and it looked like one of the young lionesses. I couldn't see any suckle mark, so perhaps it was the youngest lioness of the pride that I got a quick glimpse of, that the cubs went racing after. I think that the cubs, if they had to choose, that is their favorite aunt, the young one, the young lioness. She loves to play with them. Good little one testing its voice. Yes. You getting better? It's always quite funny to listen to them try and join in when the adults do roar or contact call. I can't help but giggle with all the sounds that are going on. Remember, you are watching a live, so absolutely live at the moment. You can't get any better than this. Look at them all trying their absolute best to forget that loudest sound. It's going to take these little ones a few more months though before they really develop their voices. Now we are live and I'd love to hear from you this morning, so if you have any questions, you're welcome to either hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or you can send us an email at questions@wildearth.tv. Look at this one getting ready to crouch. There we go, and a quick sprint. No, not really a proper attack, though. I'm just... It'll just put you in the sleeper hold over this log. Now, when I arrived, I only spotted three females, just in case you've just joined in. I just want to very quickly recap. So I spotted three lionesses, and then I only saw six cubs. Now, we're missing two of the female lionesses, of course. Remember, the Nkuhumas are five adult lionesses and then eight cubs. So I think one of the mothers is definitely missing, as well as with two cubs. I could only count six, but maybe let's try and have another count. When they do get back together again, perhaps now another female has joined and has dropped the other two off. But Jandre and I were pretty certain we only counted six when we first arrived. But we ought to have another little count. It's so exciting, there's so much going on. Chatting, sort of back and forth, the cubs running one way. You can see now, there's a little cub running just in front of the vehicle. And they're very comfortable with us. It's actually quite entertaining watching these little ones now. As soon as somebody starts their vehicle, the two oldest cubs, they think they're big and brave, and they sort of walk over to the vehicle to say, hey, what are you doing here in my home? But then they back off again. Obviously, they're quite brave now. But they will learn to relax around us and learn that we're not a bother and that we're no point wasting our energy because you're not going to get a reaction from us. So I can see one, two, three, four cubs at the moment. It's not every day that we get to hear the lions vocalizing like this. I know you'd all probably prefer a big male lion to roar, but we've got these females here who are just giving us a little taste. So now this lioness is looking back north. There's another lioness to the left of her, and she's doing the complete opposite. She's facing the other way. They're going to greet again. And while I do this, I'm going to just sit very quietly. We've gone very quiet now. Of course, when I say I'm going to sit quietly, they all stop. But as soon as there's a bit of commotion again, I'll definitely just go very quiet. So don't worry. I do want you to just enjoy this. As we're sitting here as well, I'm also trying to figure out the best way to get around this thicket, because it's quite dense in here. I think I'm going to have to actually go around. Seems like both lionesses have given up now in trying to call who is ever left behind. Maybe they were a little bit worried about leaving the kill. Maybe they were sort of communicating between each other, sort of saying, should we leave it? There wasn't really anything left, so I don't think there's any loss there. And we know what killing machines the Nkuhumas are, and there are lots and lots of buffalo around at the moment. There is definitely no shortage. Here we go, I'm going to use the luxury facility, so I think it will only be a moment, I'm sure by this evening, where the Nkuhumas will have another juicy steak between their paws. And off she goes. Right, now we're going to have to reposition. So I'm going to have to go through some treacherous bush now. So while I do this, let's go back to see how Steph's doing.
We finally managed to get to Treehouse this morning, and the same seep that we uncovered the other day and boiled some water at is still active, can you believe? So have a look at this spring. Only now it's about 3 times as big as what it was when we originally came here about 2.5 weeks ago or so. You can see there's a lot of moisture here still. I don't know if there's any moisture in it, but there's elephant that have been digging here. This wetness that you see here is from an elephant taking water out of this particular seep. And I'm gonna see if we can uncover some water inside here. Just mosquitoes, like no one's business. It smells wet and delicious. I don't think there's much water in here, but you can definitely see that the difference in the sand color is noticeable. And although there's a bit of moisture in here, I don't think there's not even a little bit to get our fingers wet. Not much at all, not even caking. And I'm down to a hard layer. These riverbeds that we're in, for lack of a better word, are layered, and depends on the time of year or the type of year, not really the time of year. If it's a wet year, it tends to be lots of sediment. If dry year, it tends to be this sandy aggregate that's easy to dig through. And it would seem that the elephants have made this cavity larger because they're trying to get along this layer of softer sand that the water's traveling through. The water will be reluctant to go through the impermeable, harder clay layers. But that is, I'm now just digging along this seep. I'm not really going into it anymore. And it's too hard for me to actually scrape with my fingers. Still just coming out damp, but not wet, with no water in the bottom there whatsoever. It's mad. I need a digging tool over here. What's this behind me? Can we fashion something out of this thing? Let's see. You can hear that noise, that scrapey noise. That's against the stone at the bottom here. And I'm not even making an indentation on it. So it looks like that's the base level of this seep. That's as far as they'd be able to go. And as you can see, not getting... Thank you for your concern about, worried about if there's an animal in this hole. Don't worry, we did check it out. It took a long time for me to come down to this hole before you joined us. I was also worried there was going to be something in there. But apart from a few mosquitoes, nothing much. Let's see if we get through this hard layer. Wow, it is hard. If it starts to get a little bit more, it looks like it's starting to compact a little bit more. There we go. Now we know why it's gotten a little bit harder. It's not because it's carrying more moisture, it's because it's carrying more clay. It's starting to stick together a little bit easier. I wonder if you go through that, if you'd be able to find water. That's crazy. Now just using this stick as a bit of a pick. Not much inside here, it's getting a little bit wetter. Let's see here. Yeah, definitely a lot more clay. You can see it busy sticking there to my fingers. But no water. Bizarre, eh? Not all just dug by elephant. Can you believe it? Very, very nice. All right, I don't think we're going to be finding water in there, to be quite honest with you. I think that little spring has seen its last day. But what it would do is collect water, which is quite nice. Now, Jason, you just asked me if there's a large tree here with some leopard or lion claw marks in. There probably is. Where one is now, the easiest way to find those types of things is actually to go to a tree where you knew a kill was in, and then go and look around over there. It's not uncommon to find scratch marks on trees, but you really have to go to a place where you know that a cat has been over the last couple of days. Other than that, you can go through the trees, heal themselves quite quickly. And so you do find them, Jason, but it's not that common to find them out on walk we're doing now. It's a lot more common just to go to where they were in a kill, for instance, and go find them from there. Now, this is actually where the water table is. This is Treehouse. Very deep at the moment. In anticipation of big rains to come this year. And I'm going to use it just to wash this off my hand. Now, I approach it quite carefully. You never know with water bodies in Africa, you never quite can tell what they're holding. Now, this one obviously doesn't have a hippopotamus in, but there's nothing that says that this won't have a crocodile in. And although we're quite far away from any permanent water, there's nothing that stops a crocodile from walking over land and walking into a water body like this and spending some time there while they're moving from place to place to look for permanent water. So always in Africa, it's a good idea to approach with caution. And what I did was I washed my hands behind this stick, using that stick as a bit of a barrier just in case it moved. I doubt that there's a crocodile in here. It's quite shallow, but still, it's always a good idea to practice caution when you can. Now, where are we going to go to next? That is a good question. I think I'm going to walk down this drainage line a little bit and see if we can find a weeping boar bean with some flowers on it and sit there and potentially watch some birds for today. Ooh, I just got a blast of musk smell in my nose as I came up over this crest. There's musk bull elephants leak a secretion, and it's got the most unbelievably pungent smell. And while I'm standing right here, it's just blowing into my face. I fully expect the owner of this particular... Wow. Can you smell that, Dave? That is very strong. All right. So now we just need to keep a weather eye open. A musk bull elephant walking around over here is definitely something to take note of. Now, the smell itself actually carries for quite some distance. I would say up to probably about a mile, you'll be able to, or humans will be able to smell the smell. This is quite pungent now where we are. And either what happened is an elephant bull has walked past where we are right now and dribbled that secretion onto the road, and we're just busy smelling that aroma, or he's standing here quite close by and as he's busy leaking off the smell, basically we're smelling it. Now, what is this secretion? What is this smell that we're smelling at the moment? It's an indicator. Musk bull elephants have about a 70% increase in testosterone in their bodies, and it makes all their glands just sort of overproduce or over secrete. And some of the secretion comes out from his prostate gland, excuse me. There we go. It's like standard six biology coming back to me over here. And they dribble the secretion, and it does two things. It indicates to other bull elephant that he's in muths and that he's more aggressive, and that it's a challenge to elephants, in other words, to male elephant, but it's also a type of aphrodisiac to female elephants. They respond much more readily to bull elephant that are in muths than they do to bull elephant that are not in muths. But I don't smell it anymore. At least it's not as strong here. So, because we didn't bump into an elephant, I would say that there's a good chance that some of the elephant tracks that were crossing there was of a male elephant with this secretion, and probably in attendance with a breeding herd. So while that by no means makes me any more or any less wary, I should say, of what's around here, it definitely tells me that the smell's not as strong up on top of the road here. Let's go around and see if we can find any other or any further indications. All right. Excuse me, my radio seems to be playing up. So we're going to send you over to Taylor. Catch up with you just now.
We are now back at the carcass, and I don't want to do too much talking because there's some great sounds coming. So like I said, turn the volume up and have a little listen. Isn't very much food left on the carcass, so the lioness that stayed behind, perhaps to guard the carcass from all the vultures that are lurking in the trees waiting for them to move off. When we started coming back with the other two lionesses and all the cubs, there was a big argument between this lioness that we're looking at now and the one on the other side. They had a bit of a brawl and they slapped each other a few times. And you can still hear a lot of the growling is coming from that lioness at the back. So perhaps she feels as though she's entitled to the last remains, seeing as she was the one that stayed behind while everyone raced off. And I'm not sure where the fourth lioness disappeared to. They sort of lost visual of her, or lost sight of her, sorry, and then came back. Now, Amber Eyes is not here, unfortunately, and I know Green Eyes was wondering. I haven't seen her yet. So I'm not sure where all the rest of the cubs are, because I can still only count six cubs. But we'll have another look. Maybe now that they're finally all together, we'll be able to have a decent look. Maybe Amber Eyes is here. Maybe she's the one that's doing all the growling at the back. I haven't really been able to see, as you can see, everyone. All the other lions are blocking my view. But we will hang tight, and then we can always have another look. Let's see. I'm going to sit quietly again. Isn't that funny? Oh, whenever you say you're going to sit quietly, it reminds me when I was at school. When during an exam, your stomach would start to rattle. Oh, quickly, go to James, let's see what he's got.
I can see the cub behind us. Oh no. They've stopped there, the rest of the troop. Can you see the male still? Is he still running? Now everyone, I know this is going to be a little difficult because what I don't want to do is create a situation where the leopard can't hear what's going on. So I'm turning the engine off and I'm just going to drive down here. Can you see anything? There, I can see the male, the baboon's coming. You got the baboon there? Heard the baboon's in there. Oh, hang on, there's a fight going on in front of us. You got them. They've got the leopard. VMP, I'm going to go forward because the baboon's down here and I thought I heard it. I hope it hasn't caught something. You see the baboon? In the big marula tree. Oh yes. There's the big baboon. That was the female, wasn't it? VMP, I think we saw Karula there. Let's sneak forward there. I'm not going to go off-road now. Oh dear, the leopard's up there. The leopard is up there. The baboon is trying to grab the leopard. I don't know which leopard that is, everyone. I'm shaking. Oh no, I think that's one of the cubs. Now everybody, if you are a sensitive viewer, well, we're all going to be sensitive about this. That, I think the female was below us. Here comes the rest of the troop now, and the leopard has taken the last resort option to try and get into the tree. I don't think that's the female. I think it is one of the cubs. Dungan. Okay, Aubrey's going to go in there. We're going to follow him. You got the leopard. There's a little cub running. Where did it go, Viam? I can't see. Okay, we're gonna go. It went left, eh? You can see the mother. Just gonna try and get into a bit of a clearing here, everybody, so we can see what's happening. I'm gonna go around the corner here. Got to be very careful about where we drive here. We don't want to make a noise. We don't want to crash around. Got to be very sensitive. This is horrible. This is really horrible. There's the baboons running to the right. This is perfectly normal, everyone. It happens all the time. I'm going to move very slowly. I know it's frustrating that we can't see what's going on. Now, I will explain to those of you who are new viewers, perhaps, and you don't understand the relationship between these primates and the carnivores. I'll explain what's going on, but basically a very big male baboon is too much of a challenge. Yeah, there's a youngster right up in the tree here. I don't know where the others have gone, but I think it's the big male who's in this tree with the little one. Okay, there we go. You can see it up there. There you can see the little leopard. I'm not going to get any closer than this. Oh, shame. All right, everybody. Let's just take stock here. You, Viam, you saw the female coming down here. We saw the other cub also coming into this area. Can't see them right now. I think you'll find, and I can't see the baboon, is the big male still in that tree? I think he got out of the tree. So he's out of the tree, that's good. But he did try and grab her there. There we go. Here comes another baboon to the right-hand side. Now, big male baboon, the same weight just about as a female, not quite as a female leopard, but he's got massive canines, he's hugely powerful, he could seriously damage her. He would kill one of these cubs, if he could get it, and he tried to grab that cub, and I don't know if he got hold of it. There was certainly a scuffle. And Aubrey has just seen the mother still running down, I think, to the south of us here. Now, you see, what do you do when you're trying to get away from a baboon? A baboon climbs as well as a leopard does. And the only advantage that leopard has right now is that of height. And it's easier to swat something coming up from the bottom than it is to grab something from the bottom. Now, the baboons are calling. The male is around here somewhere, but he's not gone after her again. So I think she's going to be okay. I cannot see what's going on here. I mean, that's tremendously exciting, but it's horribly stressful. I don't want to move just now. I just want to try and assess what's going on from here, everyone. Now, the little leopard at the top is looking a little bit more confident. You can see the ears are not so flattened against her head. Yes, sorry, and I think you are right, viewers. You're saying this is Hassan. I think you're absolutely right. I'm just saying her. It's definitely the paler-eyed one. So I'm sure it's the male. I think mum and female have headed off to behind where we are now. And I don't think we should move from here. I think we should stay exactly where we are and wait and see what transpires. Phew, that was horrid. I'm 99% sure that the other two got away. Mum definitely got away. I'm pretty sure that female would have got away too, because if they'd got hold of one, there would have been an almighty scuffle. And I think actually, look, I don't know if he was hit or look at him. From such a peaceful, wonderful morning, things have turned horrid. I think that male almost caught him. And if he may have actually made contact, because there was a, as VM saw the Karula coming down this way, I heard a scuffle on the ground, growling, and definitely a baboon making a, they don't growl, but they make a kind of throaty, almost roar. And I heard both of those things, and I'm sure the leopard was growling, and I'm pretty sure there was contact made. But a leopard is so fast. A baboon's very fast too, but a leopard's quicker. And he would have shot up that tree. Whew. Interestingly, I would also be fascinated to know what's going on at the kill site, because I wonder if they won't go and scavenge that kill. They do eat meat, baboons. They're completely omnivorous. Now, the inevitable question also is, why would a baboon do this? And it's the same reason that if there's a criminal in a neighborhood, everybody in that neighborhood will try and get rid of that criminal. And that's not to say that the leopards are criminals, but from a baboon's point of view, they are. They're predators. You don't want them around you. You want to give them a fright. You want to teach them a lesson. And that's what these baboons are doing. And they'll get their blood up, they'll feel tremendously confident, even the little ones. Now, Sarah in Georgia, you say, is this something that happens every day and we just don't see it? No, it's not, Sarah. It's not uncommon, but it's not an everyday occurrence. Sarah, I think it probably happens, yeah, more than we think it does, but it's not an everyday occurrence. And this area that we're in now seems to be a very popular baboon spot. and it's quite close to Torchwood Camp, where there's water, and the baboons like to come down to that water for some reason. Whew. And it just goes to show the baboons not, you know, they're not intent on doing harm. They're intent on getting rid of predators around where they are. So they've chased these cubs. They've chased all three. And they've now kind of relaxed. Whew. I don't feel very elated by that. I feel very sort of distressed by it. Not quite scarred, but just stressed out by it. It's not nice to see, is it? I'm sure many of you are having exactly the same emotion. We see some tremendously exciting things out here, after which we go, yes, you know, it was kind of amazing and exciting and everybody feels happy. This is something quite different. I'd quite like to know from you guys how you are feeling, so maybe tweet us through one word. Tell us how this made you feel, other than stressful. I'm sure it made you feel all stressful. There, I've got the female. I've just seen the female moving there. Well, no, it's not. It's a hyena. There's a hyena there. You won't be able to see it. Vimpy, let me move, because we know where the leopard is. Aaron, you say this was scary. Yes, it was. It is scary. It remains scary. Kuna Misi la. Misi. Misi. I'm just telling Aubrey where the hyena is. Can you see it? Oh, the leopard. There's Karula, everybody. So that's not the hyena. We've got the leopard. Maki, iko. Maki, yeah, na Maki. They're calling. Calling the little one. The little one is not reacting yet. The hyena was a long way to the right of where she is now. I suspect she's left the female further back from where she is now, going up onto the termite mound. I'm going to move just so that we can get into a position that we can see Karula and the baby, but I don't want to, we obviously don't want to interfere. There is a hyena behind us. It's quite a long way away. It's a young hyena. But also, remember, compared to the baboons, those hyenas are no threat at all. They cannot climb. That's interesting. She's walked straight past the tree. Yeah, Teresa, you say nauseous is your word. There's a certain sense of that in me as well. She's going back to the kill. Yeah, I think she's heading straight back to the kill. I also think that this little one hasn't called her. Unless she knows the little one's here and's just kind of saying, well, stay there if you want to, but we can go back to the kill if you want to. Whew. The hyena, I'm just going to point out, we're not going to try and get a film of it. It's over there, basically where VM's pointing the camera. And it's been attracted, I think, by the noise. I don't think you'd pick up the smell of the kill. And I don't know where the other little cub is. I thought I saw it heading down this way. Phew! Right, I'm just going to let Aubrey move away, and then we also will decide whether we're going to try and get a better view of the cub or leave the cub alone and go back with the mum. I think it'll probably be the latter. There's the hyena. Can you see it there, Vimpy? It's just to the left of the bottom of this marula tree there. I've parked you right in front of a stick. Can you just do, yeah, it's in there exactly where you're filming, just to the right of that. There, it's moving now to the left. That's coming now. Got it, there we are. Now, Sean, you're wondering if the hyenas would chase the baboons. Yes, because they're in a group, they are a lot braver. They can afford to be injured more than a leopard can. Remember, the big thing about what we're observing here, sorry, quickly back to the leopard, VMP, it's coming out the tree. Sean, a leopard cannot be injured. If a leopard gets injured, it cannot hunt, it will die. A hyena can afford to be injured, it lives in a group, it scavenges a lot more, and so it can take more risks than a leopard can. Now, a hyena, the one you've just seen, looks like a sub-adult male to me from this distance. It's going to struggle to ward off baboons, but it'll turn and fight much more than a leopard will. And I think you'll find that the reason the baboon didn't push home the attack on this little cub is that although it's only 8 months old, it's about the size of, say, a large Alsatian, a dog. It's still formidable. I mean, you wouldn't want to try and catch one of those things. It would tear you to pieces. And so although the baboon was happy to give it a fright, he would have thought twice about actually engaging in a full pitched battle. The leopard is not going to come out because the hyena is just over there. It's coming closer and closer towards us now, and there is no danger now to the leopard from the hyena. The hyena is utterly innocuous as a threat in comparison with those baboons. Can smell something is up. Doesn't know what's gone down here, has heard the alarm calling baboons. That's probably what attracted it into this area in the first place. I don't think it spotted the leopard. The leopard has definitely spotted the hyena. I can see it watching the hyena. So it's fully aware of that threat. But it's completely safe up in the tree now. The baboons have moved off. So Hosanna is fine, and like I say, if there had been contact between the baboon and the leopard, we would have known about it. So I think everything's okay. That's right, he's now, that base of the tree on the right-hand side of your screen is exactly the tree that Hosanna is sitting in. Hyena is behind the eight ball here. It knows something has gone down, but it's not quite sure what. So nice to see a hyena here. You know, I've missed them so much since their den moved. Poor little leopard. God, didn't he look miserable with his little ears flattened against his head up top there? I just wanted to give him a bit of a cuddle. Like I say, you don't want to be cuddling a little leopard. Now, you're all quite stressed still about Shongile. I think Shongile is fine, everybody. I'm pretty sure that she made it away. There would have been much more of a scuffle if the baboons had actually got hold of her. This is the one that the big male focused on, and therefore I'm pretty sure that the female, I'm 90% sure that the female got away. She might actually be back at the kill with mum. What do you want? What do you want? Tobias, a good one from you about baboons and whether they have claws or if it's just the teeth that you have to worry about if you happen to be a leopard that's being chased by them. They've got nails like we've got nails. They're not quite claws, but they'd be sharper than a dog's claws, for example, and they do quite a lot of damage. So they do use those, but they've got teeth that are longer than a leopard's canines. And I've got a skull. We've just bought a skull. And the next time you come into the tent with us, I'll show you the size of an adult male baboon's teeth. They're terrifying. They're that big. They're razor, razor sharp. They're not, some of the leopard's teeth are slightly blunted from biting on bone. Remember that a baboon doesn't bite on bone much. It's purely for defense. So they're these razor little spears in the baboon's face, and they are, well, they're terrifying, and that's why the leopards are so reticent to go after them. Young male leopards sometimes kill baboons, and this chap's probably going to take his revenge when he goes independent. Females, they're too experienced, they don't go for it, and even big males like Anderson and Tingana, they'll avoid baboons. Baboons will be afraid of them, but there's easier stuff out here to kill than baboons. He's still up there. Ah, thank you, Chris. Well done. I've forgotten all of these hyenas. You've been obviously observing these hyenas for a long time. You say that is Ribbon, the clan male from our clan of hyenas. So that's great. I thought he had one rather familiar spot on his right shoulder. But thank you very much for confirming that. So it is a male, and his name is Ribbon. Thanks for that, Chris. Okay, we're going to move. Let's just go. I'm going to try and get a little loop around to that side. We'll get a view of him. I'm not going to hang around with him. And we are also going to go and just do a little loop to the south. And I'll try and get hold of Aubrey just to find out where the others are. In fact, let's go straight out this way. Yeah, curious one. You say, can I hear the baboons still? No, I can't. They've gone, I think. I don't want to hang around here. Aubrey, do you copy? Orbs confirm. Kurula's gone back to the kill. Try and put Aubrey on. Okay, copy that. I haven't seen the other youngster, just the male there. I'll come back to you if I can. Confirm how many vehicles there. We're not going to go back to Karula. I think there are too many vehicles there at the moment. Okay, copy. We'll try and come back later. No problem. It seems that there are too many vehicles there at the moment. We've had an amazing sighting. So what we'll do is just do a little turn around here and see if we can't see the female. All right, while we're doing that and catching our breath and letting our heart rates go down, well, a little bit, let's head across to Steph. He's got an elephant.
Wow, what an exciting sighting you've been seeing. Well, we haven't been chased up a tree. We definitely have been termite mounded by a herd of elephants, and you can see that bull elephant just heard my voice there. We have no other choice but to be on the termite mound we are. It gives us a beautiful view over the bush around us. And he was unaware of where we are. We actually came here to see one of my favorite trees, if not my favorite tree on Juma. This is that massive weeping burbeen on top of that gigantic Termite Mound. And as we climbed up here, he was standing on the other side. Now, he can hear us. You can see that very, those ears basically cocked above the level of his shoulders. That is an elephant listening intently. Now, the herd of elephant that he's associated to is in an arc about 180 degrees from him, off to your left-hand side and our left-hand side. And it's just one of those days where we're just being cautious. Blustery, windy days like this today definitely add a measure of caution to what we do out here, especially on foot. He's just got his face buried in that bush that he's at. Quite content to keep on feeding with us talking at this distance. And that to me is a very, very good sign. It tells me that we're sort of on that edge of that zone where he knows we're here, but he doesn't really care. And that is the single best place to be with some elephant. Would an elephant be able to climb up this massive termite mound? No doubt. Would they want to? No, not really. Have a look here. The rest of the herd is coming out of the bush here, Dave. All over there, you can see that's the front runners of the herd. It's a couple of hundred yards away. I'd say probably about 200, maybe 150 yards away from where we're standing now. And everywhere I'm looking, I'm just getting movement of feet. Now, that elephant is having our breeze blow almost straight onto her. I would fully expect at a point that these elephants would make a noise. Sometimes it's audible, sometimes we can hear it, sometimes we can't. And then they just sort of melt into the bush. Yeah, there we go. You see that? See that all of a sudden, that sudden movement? Now that was an elephant that caught a big trunk full of our smell. Not that it's offensive, but I think that's just in my defense. I think I smell quite nice today, as does Dave. I'm just seeing elephant everywhere. There's another one through the gap there, just that dark shape across this tree, this line of trees there. Don't worry about finding, we've got lots of ellies to look at close by to us. Now, the trick is what we're doing here now is, where do we go to from here? I've now come and said hello to this beautiful tree, which still hasn't got any flowers on. And we've now got elephant everywhere. Now the decision is, where do we go from here? We've got elephant basically now in about a 200 degree arc around us. And although we're very safe at the moment, we won't be when we're down at eye level with them again. And I think, you know, the best thing to do in these circumstances is to just sit down on top of your termite mound and enjoy the sighting. And that is precisely what we're going to be doing while you go back to James.
Well, everybody, he's chilled out. He's in the same tree. We did a brief loop around to see if we could find the female. We haven't managed to find her. We're going to have another look now. But Hosanna is now relaxed. He's okay. He's just taking stock of the day. His heart rate slowly starting to drop. I can confirm that Karula is back with the kill, but she's on her own. And she's okay and not looking stressed at all, so I think you'll find that everything is all right. We are going to have a brief look for Shongile. And as Viam said, not easy to spot them in the trees, but you can see he's okay there. He's perfectly relaxed. In fact, he's going to sleep, which he deserves. at the back end of his real adrenaline rush. Look at that. Yeah, Sheila, I agree with you. You say things like this really bring home what a good mum Karula has been. You know, there are huge, huge dangers, huge trials. It's not easy raising cubs out here. Shadow is a testament to that. I mean, there could be other issues with Shadow, but yeah, Karula's 10th baby is here and well on their way to independence. And the little one up there, now very much relaxed. He's full of food, so he's going to be fine. He's going to come down a bit later. I don't know that he'll come down on his own with us here. So although he doesn't look like he wants to come down, we're not going to sit here for long before we head off. And Catherine, I agree with you as well. You say Shungile will be okay. You're sure of it. I'm pretty sure of it too. Let's go and have a look. Now, what I think Viam and I saw, we think, was Shungile basically off to the right-hand side there where I'm pointing, running down this way. That's certainly what Karula did. And I think we're pretty sure we saw two leopards going that way. So we'll just do a little loop around there and see if we can't spot her. Be a little bit of a crunch as we go over this dead tree. Oh dear, there goes the virtual. Fishtailed. I've got the virtual reality rig now very solidly stuck on a knobthorn tree, and forward or back is going to destroy it. You can't take it off. There's a leopard in the tree. We might have to link away if we can. Is there any way we can get away from here, Kirst? We've got to get this camera off the front. That's okay. No, it's okay. It's okay. We've managed to do it. It's okay. We're all right. Luckily, it's a cheap piece of equipment on the front there, hey, Vim? Okay. There's a bit of a hangy bit there. It's a bit worrying. Oh well. He's stood up and he's looking this way, which is not where his mum is. Maybe he can see a baboon somewhere around here. Now, these marula trees would be ideal for a little female leopard to be hiding in. So we'll just do a very gentle, slow loop through here. We don't want to escalate any situation. Yeah, Jason, I'm not surprised, and absolutely I understand. You say you had to stop watching because you thought you were going to have a heart attack, and you don't know what happened. Right, let's have a little recap. Jason, I'm not going to look at you while I'm talking to you because I'm just going to try and see if we can spot the leopard in the trees here. Jason, what happened was a baboon troop just happened by here, and I'm just listening to a game drive operate. Okay, it was just an update on Karula. She's moved the kill under some cover, so that's good. Jason, the baboons just were feeding. They came along, and then they caught sight and smell of the leopards, and they gave chase. And that's what baboons do. As I said, it's a bit like the neighborhood watch, chasing a gang of criminals out of the neighborhood. And that's not to say that leopards are criminals, but they are, of course, if you happen to be a baboon. And leopards will kill small baboons. They don't kill baboons in this area a lot, but it does happen from time to time, and baboons are not tolerant of it. Then the male gave chase, and we both, Viam and I, both think that he got hold of Hosanna there. And I'm pretty sure that that Hosanna gave him a bite, gave him a slap, and after that slap, made the baboon let him go, ran up the tree, and the baboon went up after him and then tried to grab him out of the tree, and he managed to fight the baboon off. And that's what happened. Then things calmed down. Karula's gone back to her kill. And that is the lay of the land, Jason. I don't see a leopard around here. Just have an update from Andrew. I'm just going to try and find out what he said again. Sorry, Andrew, can you go again to that update? I'm afraid I missed it. Oh, interesting update from Andrew. Copy, thank you. He's found a mvula. Alarm calls. Let's just listen. There, he's right, there's an impala alarming behind us. Okay, copy, thanks. We've just got some impala alarming around here. I wonder if it's not the little leopard. Let's head up through that way. We can go back to Karula, everybody, because they've made this a space there. All right, while we have a look here, let's head back to the lions with Taylor, and we'll keep you posted with this rather difficult situation.
We're still sitting with these wonderful lions, and they've been providing so much entertainment this morning. I did get a little bit concerned at one point because they all looked like they were going to go back to sleep. And I do wish Karula and her cubs well, and I'm sure they'll be manage to fend off those baboons. Well, they've managed to find a nice chunk of flesh. We've got a few more coming to join. And something that Chandra and I were talking about is that the teddy bear cubs are not quite teddy bears anymore. I can't believe that in 10 days they have almost doubled in size. It's quite fantastic. And I did a recount because finally the cubs all settled down and came back together, and there are now 8 cubs here. So I think when we had that bit of commotion earlier with the other lioness joining very briefly, I think she may have dropped the cubs off, because there were definitely only 6 cubs when we first started and when we first arrived here this morning. So that's good. That's good to know. Here's one of the little teddy bears. Hello, little one. Now, you're probably looking at your screen, and I'm sure you are wondering, and I know Brent has spoken about it, but you can see this little one does have a little bit of mange, and it's doing fine. I don't think there's anything to worry about just yet. A little bit itchy, but I'm sure Mom is taking good care of this little one, grooming it, and perhaps it'll survive. I think they'll do well. The other cubs seem to be in fantastic nick, and this one doesn't seem to look too bad at all. Just a few patches here and there, especially on the ears. But that could also be the flies biting their ears, because I've seen the other cubs look like they've got a few nibbles from the flies, and they can be quite pests. But remember that mange is a natural thing, and it's something that does occur, and it's important to control populations. That's why we have all these diseases and things around. But we'll keep our fingers crossed. But I have faith in the Nkuhumas. I think they're going to do just fine. Remember, you've always got to have a positive mindset. Like with Karula, I think she's going to fend off those baboons. I don't think she's going to let any one of them touch her little cubs. She's an incredible mother. We've seen it. Well, she's proven it year after year. You can see this one just having a little scratch, licking in between the padding of the paws. There we go. Hello. Now, it'll be quite interesting to see when we get the entire pride back together, because they've been separated for a few days today. And Bill, you were wondering, when you get a pride of lions, in that pride, is there any lioness that's considered the queen? Now, not from what I've seen. However, when I was down in the southern Sabi Sand with a southern pride, also 5 lionesses, and now I believe they've got 8 cubs too, there was an old lady in that pride, and her name was Mandlev. And she must have been about 15 years old. I mean, she was a really old lion, but she looked beautiful. The only thing that gave her age away was when she did a big yawn and she exposed her canines, and you could see they were worn down slightly. Now, We used to see a little bit more dominance from her, so that when they would go out and hunt, she was often the first one up and eager and ready to go and getting the rally riled up. But I think the role between the lions is quite spread out. That'll be something to note. It's definitely not too much of not as a definite matriarchal cycle like you see with the elephants. I'm just going to keep quiet. There's a bit of growling going on. Oh, no, stop. Typical. Whenever I say something, they stop doing this. Don't worry, I haven't forgot about my buffalo story either. I will definitely tell you, but it's just so exciting at the moment. Maybe in a few minutes, while you're watching the lions, I shall tell you. You can see, I can't believe some of these cubs are still suckling. It's so funny. I'm sure the mothers, though, are starting to produce less and less milk every day. Because the cubs are getting quite old now. Even the teddy bears must be almost... I've been here a month, so they must be all between 4 and 5 months now, aging quickly. That's something that I've noticed. Unfortunately, what we do as guides is we tend to forget that the animals age too. Now we're listening to all these little ones growl and make all strange sounds. Robin wants to know when do the lions or the youngsters get their adult voices. I think it's going to take them quite a few months before they eventually get the proper sound. We heard it this morning of them all attempting to roar and contact call and copy the adults. So for the males, I think they're only going to get their proper, well, they'll be, have a good sounding voice at about 2 years old. But I think that deepness of their voice is really only going to come in a few years after that. It'll just keep improving. And of course, as for the females, their voices aren't as deep as the boys. So I think around anywhere from about, let's say, a year and a half to 2 years, they should be sounding very much like adults. But for now, we get to enjoy the strange dinosaur sounding sounds that come from their voices. It reminds me of the Jurassic Park movies when they make all the bizarre noises. Well, this female, she's found a good chunk of flesh. There really isn't anything left on this buffalo now. She's eaten it. She's reached the skin. They're going to have to keep turning it upside down and around and perhaps start eating along the legs. There's a few little chunks of flesh. You can see her sticking her head right in though. Here we go. You see her pull and tug. And of course, the little ones keep trying to steal her spot. You can see they're trying to creep in to try and get some good little bits as well. I have having a good chuckle in the front. It sort of reminds me of these videos that everybody puts up on all the different social media where it's mom or dad and their kids follow them around and they can't even do anything without their little ones at their feet. And it just proves you, it's not just with humans, it's with the animals too. I mean, kids are everywhere you go. You can't get rid of them, which is not a bad thing, of course. But I'm sure it would be nice to have some peace and quiet and be able to eat dinner, breakfast or lunch on your own. See how she's using her paw now. She pulls, rips away at the flesh. Oh wow, some gruesome sounds going on. Hope you can hear all that sniffing and snorting and tearing as she rips the flesh off of the carcass. Isn't this lovely? All the cubs seem to be spread out there. It's like they don't need to rely on mom so much anymore. They're getting braver and braver as the days go by. Oh my goodness, my stomach's grumbling. I hope you can't hear that. This is so lovely. Now it's quite overcast today. It's a really beautiful out here, nice and cool. I think we'll hang around with the Ngahumas just for a little bit longer. And while we wait, let's go back to James. And I think Karula has finally arrived at the impala carcass.
Karula hasn't arrived so much as we haven't found her. Aubrey found her and followed her. And she's pulled this carcass some distance. We're a good 200 meters, 600 feet from where we saw this kill this morning. And I think she's decided to take it towards a tree where she can stash it. And then she can go and fetch the cubs. I think she's almost said to them, you stay where you are. I'll get this thing off the ground away from the baboons and the place where they are. She's dragged it straight into Juma. So she's pulled it away from Torchwood around where those baboons focus. And I think she's calling. No, she's not calling. She's just breathing heavily. And I think she's going to go and hoist it into a tree so that there's some safety for all concerned. You can see how heavily she's breathing. It's still quite a lot of impala left. It's not a male, it's a female impala. I think what I heard Brent say last night was probably that it's an adult impala as opposed to adult male impala. It's got no horns on it. She's just waiting, I think, trying to maybe ascertain where the cubs are. So I haven't told you where we are. If you picture where the kill was, where we saw them, the kill was basically sitting just inside Torchwood. Now what she's done is pulled it south and west into Juma by about 600 feet, like I say. The male cub, Hosanna, is off to the north of where we are now, probably equidistant from the kill, so about 600 meters to the north, 600 feet, 200 meters to the north. Don't know where Shongile is at this stage. I think she's further south. We had some impala alarm calling and we went to investigate, but what I think that was probably them spotting her dragging this thing across the road. See, definitely no horns, well, or ears anymore on that impala. She's there. There is a large marula tree, and I'm going to take the chance, everybody. She's heading towards it. I'm going to take the chance of not heading towards her, but going around the side and seeing if we can't get to a position by the tree so that when she does get there, we can see her pull it up. We also, of course, don't want to be too close to her because we don't want to affect her ability to hear the cubs, which may or may not be caught. I don't think they'll call her. I think she might try and call them, though. I think they will remain completely silent right now. Small gap here. Hold on, everybody. Hello, Alina. You're wondering while we negotiate through this narrow spot. She's going straight to the same tree. Alina, you want to know if the baboons carry disease and if they'd bitten Hosanna, whether they'd have infected him with something. It's possible. It is possible, but remember the animals out here have profoundly powerful immune systems, so I think that he would have got over that. Which one do you think she's going to pick, Vim? Looks like she's not going to pick either, yeah, I must confess, I agree with you. Just going to ease our way in here. Great amount of aardvark activity that goes on in this area. There, she's going to take it up this one. It's not the best view, everybody, but I think it's about the best that we're going to get. Let me move quickly, give her a chance while she catches her breath. Right, Jimpy. it's still very, very heavy. I'm going to just quieten my voice a little bit here now. Yeah, I think she feels it's slightly too heavy for her to take up a tree just at the moment. So she's going to sort of stash it underneath that thick bush there. And I think once she's caught her breath, because she's dragged it quite a long way, I think then she might try and put it up into the tree. Well done, Mom. What a morning you've had. What a life you've had. Hello, Lauren. Another one that is difficult to answer. Thank you for it. You say, if the baboons had hurt the cubs or Karula, would the reserve have stepped in to help? The short answer is no. The long answer is probably. You know, this is an iconic leopard, and she brings a lot of tourists into this area very often. And I think what you'd find is that although there's a general policy of non-interference, if there had been an easily solvable injury, like, you know, maybe the baboon had torn a piece of fur off the back of her, and, you know, with a simple stitching job it could have been fixed, I think you'll find they would have probably called the vet. But that is not policy. So the official stance would be no, there would be no interference. The unofficial one, I think, would have been if it was a seemingly easily solvable issue, then they would have got the vet in. Phew, what a morning. Michael, you're wondering if this talent of getting away from baboons runs in the family, because Karula, at least Tandi, managed to escort her two cubs away from the baboons last time. I think it's largely instinctual. I don't believe that it's necessarily genetic. I think it's almost purely... Sorry, I'm just listening. She's going to fetch the cubs now. We're not going to follow her. I'm going to let her be, because I think that she needs a little bit of time to go and fetch the cubs, and I think it might be worth just sitting here and waiting. Oh, this is amazing. So, Michael, no, I think it's purely instinctual stuff that, I mean, it's almost, Michael, like they split, you know, it's hardly like it looked almost like Tandi was trying to chase, I don't know if any of you saw that, but it looked like Tandi perhaps tried to lure the baboons away from the cubs. I'm not convinced that that's what happened. And certainly with these three, they all ran in different directions. Karula was on the periphery, but remember, if she dies, those cubs will die, and so she won't take the risk. She simply will not take the risk that she could die as well. And then a nice one, I forget the name, sorry, Kirsten, you'll have to come back with that, about whether or not her age is going to make a difference. It's Bill, thank you, Bill. About whether her age is going to make it difficult for her to take kills like this up a tree or not. Yeah, eventually, you know, she gets a little bit older, it's definitely going to make a difference. But I don't think yet. I mean, I've seen her hoist a male impala before. I think if you're all happy, I think we're just going to sit right here, if that's okay, and we'll just see if she doesn't come back with the cubs. So while we do that, let's head to the lions, find out what they're doing with the inimitable Taylor, and make sure this time that she tells you her buffalo story without the language she used.
Ah, James, you're so funny. I would have loved to have seen what actually happened from sort of James's view. And yes, I did possibly use quite a bit of foul language yesterday. So let me quickly tell you about the buffalo story, but we'll hopefully nothing interesting happens, otherwise I'm going to end up telling this story 100 times, right? So, as you know, I'm the fossicker in chief. I do a lot of collecting of insects and a variety of different things for James. I'm just trying to get comfortable, but it's a bit tight in here. And so anyway, I was going about my day as normal. I wasn't far from the tent at all. I was really close. Maybe I sort of walked out. Are they doing? I'm just going to keep looking back at the lions because they've stood up now. See, I know this is going to happen. I'm going to come back and forth to my story, but we'll get there. Now, some of the cubs also got up and moved away. Now we've got another lion there standing and listening. I think they're all anticipating the arrival of the rest of the Nkuhumas. I think that's what they're missing. It doesn't look like anything sort of too interesting. Perhaps just changing position. Right, so I was out collecting, and I always stop and listen. That's one of the most important things you have to do when you're on foot. So I stopped and I listened and I said, I'm going to do what I did. And I looked around and I thought I heard something I didn't, and I carried on walking. And I was probably, I don't think I was more than about between 60 and 80 meters away from the tent. And I found a velvet ant. So I reached down and I took my multi-tool out, and I picked I picked the velvet ant up, and I put a leaf underneath it, and I was walking very carefully not to drop this ant because I thought, oh, amazing, I found something fantastic for James. So as I'm walking back very, very slowly, I stopped and I had a quick look around again, nothing. And I'm not joking, it was maybe 20 meters, 25 meters from the tent, and I stopped dead. And it was amazing. My whole body went cold, and I heard the snort, and I turned to my right, so I went just like that. My eyes grew about 10 times the size, and I was maybe 30 meters away from a big buffalo bull. He looked at me, and I think the way he was walking, you know, that typical buffalo stride, head dangling down on the ground, he looked up at the same time, and I think he got a big fright. So he snorted and I stood still, but the next thing he started charging me and flat out. Now I'm close to him. I can't tell you how close I was. So I look and I was like, I've got no tree to climb. I'm not standing my ground anymore. He was close and he was flat out charging now. Head down, coming for me. So I just booked it. I ran straight into the tent, shouting a variety of words. And then one of them being buffalo, that one I can tell you. Into the tent I went, and James latched onto me, grabbed me, and everyone was very confused. Thank goodness, nothing. I don't think anything was recorded. And David was in there too. And David saying, "Is he gonna come back?" And then I was like, "Oh my goodness! Imagine if he turns and chases us into the tent. We'd have to dive out the windows." It was very exciting, and I think I did see my life flash before my eyes. But now when somebody says to me, "It's impossible that you can outrun a buffalo," I can tell them different. I'm quite proud of this. But let's quickly go back to the lions. They're obviously missing the attention of the camera. There's all sorts of things going. But don't worry, I come out Oh, sorry, Kirsty's telling me now. You probably heard that, how fantastic that was. I'm glad you enjoyed it. But I'm unscathed. I have one little scratch on my leg from a branch that hooked me, but that's nothing I've never had before. So I'm good. And we can see this lioness has applied another coat of lipstick to her lips. That almost sounded like a dog barking. Did you hear that? And it's again, it's that same young cub that we've watched since this morning, still eating and still having a go at this lioness. The line. come on, you've got big bellies, you've got tummies full of milk, you've got tummies full of buffalo. Oh, I think we're going to get a bit more commotion, especially if this other lioness comes over. Oh, they're all making lots and lots of noise. I'm also hearing some elephants in the background. I can hear them pushing trees amongst all the growling that's going on. She's found herself a tasty morsel. Delicious. Isn't that incredible? Look at that lovely bright red. That'd make an amazing screenshot. It's like a Halloween photo. It'd give you some ideas. You could go as a lion who's just fed on a buffalo kill. It would probably look quite similar to the Joker's face though, with those bright red lips. But add a few ears, maybe a mane, and I think you're good to go as a Halloween, go as one of the Nkuhumas or one of the Birminghams. Now it's quieting down. I'm really, really happy that you, as I keep start talking, they make a lot of noise. Ooh, just checking up in the air, see if it was a vulture that flew. Right. But I hope you've enjoyed the Nkuhumas this morning. I think we're going to say goodbye to them now and let them rest peacefully and allow the other guides to come through. But I hope you enjoyed that. But let's go back to James and see how Madam Karula's doing.
She came back, everybody, and she's just calling. I'm sure the cubs are just behind her. She was walking back and she turned round and looked and turned on and looked. And then called, and then she came back to the carcass and tossed some leaves on it. And I'm pretty sure that the cubs are just a little bit skittish to move into open ground. And between us, it doesn't look like it from where you're looking, but behind that thicket there's an open area, and I think they're just a little nervous at the moment. They or one, or I don't know. And when I say I don't know, if there's more than one, I just simply mean in this particular instance, I'm pretty sure they're both fine. She came right back here. She's going off onto the termite mound. I think there's a termite mound behind there. I don't want to move. She's going onto the termite mound to have a look-see. I just don't want to move and make a noise. Well, that wasn't particularly exciting, was it, Vim? We can. Should we have a little move around, Vimpy? We'll just do a little sort of foray around there and see. She's gone quite far, so we're not going to disturb her. Cotton in Colorado, you're wondering whether Karula would have made sure that Shongile was all right before she went back to the kill to fetch it. You know, I don't think so. I don't know that she knew where the female was. I'm not convinced that she knew. But like I say, the thing watching like we watched, the lips and lions will not risk their own lives for their youngsters. They can't afford to, because if they die, their cubs die anyway. And so there's no point in them risking their own lives. And so they are not, you know, she would never have risked her, she wouldn't necessarily have checked on the cubs before she went back to feed. That said, I don't know that that's true. I mean, I don't know that she wouldn't have checked, so maybe she had a look and to see whether Shongile was okay. I'm not sure. It's interesting. These discussions all go into that area where we talk about animal emotions and animal feelings and how much those drive what they do. And, of course, the big thing for scientists for so many years was, well, animals don't feel anything, they don't have emotions. And that was patently, obviously untrue to anybody who had a house cat or a dog, which obviously feel things. And I've been reading quite a lot about it lately. And far from being a kind of completely anthropomorphic response, she's gone off that way and Aubrey's following her there, so I think we'll just gently trickle along behind. Far from being a kind of anthropomorphic impression of our own feelings onto animals, or reflecting our own feelings, emotions play a hugely strong evolutionary role in how animals react to certain situations. And the emotion that a leopardess would feel for the dangers that her babies feel, or that her babies are under, is hugely important, because if she didn't feel that, she'd be almost psychopathic and she wouldn't look after them. She would feel no need to look after them. And so I'm pretty sure that what she felt during that during that attack from the baboons was terror. And I think it probably quite closely approximated what a mother human would have felt with her children under such threat. And remember that a human being and a hyena and a wild dog, they will take far more risk than a leopard will. And so will a lion, because of course they live in a group. So they know that if they get injured, they'll still be able to eat. Now, I don't know what Aubrey's doing. I'm just going to call him quickly. Orbs, have you got visual there? Okay. What she's doing is she's gone back to where the kill was, and she's calling them there. So she obviously doesn't know where they are. And Aubrey's leaving the area now. Okay, I think what we're going to do, everybody, I'm not going to go and sit with her. I want her to be able to hear what's going on. We're going to go back to the kill and wait there. While we do that, let's head across to Steph and find out what he's managed to step on with his fairly substantial size 11s, I think they are. Well, he may be stomping about the place, but he's not, in fact, audible at all. Sorry about that. Not sure why. I'm sure they'll sort the problem out now. So, like I say, we're just going to head straight back to the kill. I'm not going to go after her. I wanted to have the maximum opportunity to hear what's going on. It's also why I'm trickling along at this speed and not going any faster than I am now, because I don't want the engine to roar and I don't want there to be great crashing of bushes. So it is a little bit tiresome driving at this speed, but you know, it does afford us an opportunity to relax and get our heart rates down after what was a very stressful morning. And Kirsten, can you confirm whether our rehearsal this afternoon is public or private? I'm just trying to find out. I keep forgetting which ones are public and which ones are private. So you will have a drive this afternoon, so don't worry. Even if we don't see the cubs again today, you'll get an update this afternoon. It will be from 3:30 to 5:30, so it will be a truncated version as we do our rehearsals for TV, but we will come back here, so don't worry. I'm very interested that she came back, checked on the kill, kind of looked behind as if to say, well, I thought they were behind me, but they just weren't. So I'm not sure what's going on there. I thought maybe I'd seen a little leopard cub in a tree, but I haven't. Okay, let's go back to the kill and we'll just lurk there. Meanwhile, the one positive of the morning, certainly from our point of view, has been the fact that VM and I have both warmed up as a result of that action, and we're both very grateful for that. Okay, while we wait, I think I've lost this kill. While I try and find it again, let's head across to Taylor. She's got some, very, very nastily called part of the stupid five.
We're in the Mara. We're in the Mara. This is the biggest herd of wildebeest I've seen ever in the Sabi Sand. We cannot be in the Sabi Sand anymore. We must have magically teleported into the Mara. This is incredible. This lovely breeding herd, as you can see, coming down. We're at the dam cam. We're not far. You probably could see one wildebeest, which looks like the male that's off into the distance. And I think he's watching all these wonderful ladies that are going to come through. Now, it's actually a good spot for them to come down and feed on over here. There's all that lovely new green grass that's just coming through. You can sort of see the darker patches over the white sand. And it's nice and short, which is the length of grass that they love to eat. And, well, there's also a bit of water. Not that it's particularly hot today, so I don't know if they're going to come and have a drink just yet. But, I mean, this is fantastic, and this is what I love. I mean, I've been in the Sabi Sand now for a year and a half, more than a year and a half. Like I said, I finally just seen the biggest herd of wildebeest. I mean, isn't that wonderful? Now, we've left the Nkuhumas. I thought that they needed a little bit of a break, and there were lots of other guides who were wanting to come and see them. Isn't that quite special to spend so much time with the Nkuhumas? And I'm so glad, first time since I've been back. Now, we're going to just try and reposition. Oh, we've got elephants as well, Joy. We've got wildebeest and elephants. Hopefully we'll be able to get around to them. But I want to have one more look at the wildebeest. Because I know, is it practice? Sorry, I couldn't hear Kirsty too well. Would like to know this morning, are wildebeest aggressive? Now, you'd think, because they just eat grass, that of course they couldn't do any harm. But I must tell you, when I was working down in the Eastern Cape, so on the southeast coast of South Africa, there were quite a few attacks on people by wildebeest. Now, I think what happens is that people become quite complacent with the herbivores and things like the zebra, impala, bushbuck, wildebeest, and they think, oh, these animals couldn't do anything. Now, remember, they can weigh kilograms, probably quite a bit more than that, and they're armed with those horns. Now, I think if you were to come across a territorial bull, remember the males mark and defend territories. Can we show them the male that's in the distance just over there? We're going to show you him just to see how he's sort of standing higher up and looking down on his ladies below. That looks like a male over there. Now, they mark and defend territories practice. So this is what happens. He's got this beautiful area where he's got a permanent source of water. He's got lovely grazing. And of course, he's got a bit of shelter and some bushes and things to hide behind. So this is the perfect area for a breeding herd to come through. Now, if you're coming into this male's territory, perhaps when the females are coming into estrus, he could be quite aggressive towards you. And I think that's what happened. Look at all the elephants coming down now. Ah, lovely. Here we go. Got a line of elephants. And I've seen it before where I've had a friend who was unfortunately chased by a wildebeest, but he stopped. And I think that's what happens. Like I said, people become complacent and try to do silly things with the animals, and they get too close, or perhaps they just come across them on the wrong day, the wrong time of the month, whatever it may be, and they can indeed kill people. So it's always good to be aware. I'm going to reverse. I think they're going to go to the dam cam, the elephants. I'd like to obviously get a better view of them. Now, Jandra, are you ready? I'm nervous. I don't have any mirrors, and now I need to go backwards on the dam wall. So I'm going to very quickly just focus over the back of my shoulder so I don't drive us off the edge. We're going to just swing in over here. Oh, we did it. We didn't die today. It's obviously not my time to go just yet. Fantastic. So if you have a look at the dam camera, you should actually be able to see those elephants going straight there. And that's exactly where we're going. We're only about 2 minutes away. We're just going to go down through the drainage and we'll zip on around. And that wildebeest is going to get a big fright. I'm afraid he's going to be chased away by all those elephants. Come on, Jigger, you can do it. This is going to be fantastic. Oh, they're just getting there. Okay. Oh, they haven't bothered our friend the wildebeest too much. So you can watch the elephants. Oh, there's a hippo as well. Oh my goodness, look at all the commotion. Hippo versus hippopotamus versus wildebeest who's actually just having something to eat this morning. Okay, what I'm going to do is I do want to give them a bit of space. So I'm just going to go off the road slightly because I do need to give them space. Not much though. Look at this. I'm going to line you up perfectly so you can get fantastic screenshots. How's that? That is beautiful. Sorry, I've parked on a bit of a angle. Isn't that amazing? Now remember to take screenshots and I look forward to seeing them all a little bit later. So remember to hashtag SafariLive if you're sharing them on Twitter. Or you can email us your pictures at questions@wildearth.tv. And I'd also like to hear from you. I'm going to snap one or two photos because this is just too beautiful not to take advantage of. It's not every day that we get to see a beautiful big hippo and a lovely herd of elephants. Now I'm having obviously problems. I can't fit all the elephants in the screen because my lens is too long. Oh, the dramas that the troubles that I have to live through every day. Now I don't think the elephants are going to spend too much time here. I think they're just going to come down and quench their thirst. Look at that little one nudging mom away, saying move over, make some space. So I think they're just going to have a little quench their thirst, and then I think they will probably move on and continue with their day. Now it's not very hot, so I don't think we're going to see any mud splashing. No, already they're starting to shuffle and some of them are starting to move off. So it was really just to wet the mouth. Isn't that lovely? You can see the wildebeest now in the background as well, staring at the elephants. And off they go. Wasn't that perfect timing? And that's what safaris are often about. It's about just getting to the right place at the right time. And we indeed were at the right place at the right time. So I also must say a big thank you to practice, because if it wasn't for your question, we could have possibly moved on and missed the elephants coming down. They were hiding in the thick bushes. So everything happens for a reason. Isn't that beautiful? Now they just seem to be smelling the air. You can see that elephant moving its trunk around a little bit in the front. Just having a little sniff. Not a particularly big herd. There's another one smelling the air. Maybe they're picking up on the scent on the lions. We're not too far away from them. And these elephants are downwind of the lions. So perhaps that's what they're smelling now. They're moving off. Let's see if they're going to go back down into the drainage line and maybe chase the wildebeest away for us. That would be quite funny, wouldn't it? Well, we're actually right in front of one of the lodges, which is quite spectacular. It just shows you how close and personal you can get. Sometimes you don't even need to go on a game drive, on a little bumble. You can just sit on the deck, here we go, and you can just watch all the animals go by. I mean, you think, how often do you see the lions and how often do we see leopards on the dam cam? Now you'd be able to see all of that from the lodge. And off they go. The last two members catching up now from behind. They're also finished drinking. Here they are. Bye, ladies. Wasn't that beautiful? Welcome, Peter. Peter, you, and firstly, Peter's a new viewer. Peter, I hope you continue watching us. I'm twisting around. I don't know which way my body wants to go this morning. Now, Peter, we're actually out in the middle of Africa, but to be more specific, we are in South Africa at the moment, and we are situated in the northeastern corner of South Africa on a private game reserve called Juma in the Sabi Sand. Isn't that amazing? And we get to see all these wonderful, amazing animals without having to interfere too much. We obviously bumble around in the vehicle, so we make a little bit of noise. So in no way are these animals tame. They're completely wild. The lions hunt for themselves. I don't know if you were watching earlier, but we actually had lions eating a buffalo. Oh, look at, there go all the wildebeest. They've been chased away now. Look at that. They were not happy. Now it does look like a migration. I think those elephants were just getting a little bit too close for their comfort. You can see they're all staring back. Not very impressed with the elephants, of course. And like James, I think James was saying yesterday that the elephants are definitely the king of the jungle. Size really matters, and there are very few creatures and other animals that that will tackle on an elephant. But I hope you enjoyed that. But let's go back to Steph and see how his walk is going this morning.
Our walk is going fine, thank you very much, Taylor. Yeah, it's going so well with the rest of everybody. It's just nice to be able to explore as much as we have done today. One of the things that we managed to do was follow a lilac-breasted roller for the last couple of minutes. The reason for that is that this time of the year, lilac-breasted rollers are busy nesting. They are cavity nesting birds. In other words, they like to nest in the hole of trees made by woodpeckers or barbets. And we've managed to find a lilac-breasted roller's nest. Inside this peltiforum, this African wattle, is a branch, quite a prominent branch going up through the middle of the tree. The arced branch in the middle that sort of arcs off towards us, relatively speaking, has two holes in it, just at the arch. You'll notice a little bit. So let's go from the bottom of the tree all together. So we come out the bottom of the tree, there's three prominent wings. One to the left, one to the right, and then one going straight up. If we follow the branch going straight up, all the way, and until it arches, yep. On the arch are two holes in the tree there. And inside the bottom arch is the nest of a lilac-breasted roller. Now we're just sitting over here waiting to see if the lilac-breasted roller actually returns. I'm wanting to know, let's see if we can see her. I heard her just now. Just trying to see if we can see her in one of the trees over here to show you. But they've got some babies. Probably find the female is sitting on the eggs at the moment. They both have terns, both the male and the female have terns sitting on the eggs, where the other partner will then ferry food backwards and forwards to that one. Quite nice. Now, usually with hole nesting birds, the eggs are quite brightly colored, white, or at least a reflective color, so the birds can actually see the eggs relatively easily. And the eggs are usually round, and that's so that they always fall to the center of the nest. So even in the dark, the birds always realize that the eggs are most likely to be in the center of the nest. Birds that nest on cliff edges have eggs that are tapered. If you hold up a chicken's egg, you'll notice that it's tapered towards the top, and that's so that when that egg rolls, it always rolls in a circle or relative circle, and that's to stop the egg from rolling off of the side of a cliff or rolling out of a poorly constructed nest. So generally speaking, the rounder the egg, the more cup-shaped and the more vessel-shaped is the nest. Usually the tapered eggs with the most tapered eggs are nests that are very poorly constructed, nests on the ground or nests on the edges of cliffs, and it allows that egg to rotate around itself. Isn't that interesting? Right, I don't see these rollers anywhere. Let me take a quick scan of the trees around us and see if we can. I heard that roller the last time was about a couple of minutes ago. They flew out of this tree when we got here, but now, of course, because I want to show you. All right, we're going to go and have a closer look. But while we're getting closer to the nest and look for this, Taylor's hippo has climbed out of the water.
You've got here just in time. That's an interesting angle, Chandra. That is indeed a hippopotamus exiting the dam. And I think he's going to take full advantage this morning of the lovely cool and overcast weather that we've had to go for a bit of a munch. I think he was just waiting for the elephants to move out. He looks a bit stiff still. Looks like he hasn't quite woken up just yet. Let's see what you get up to. Oh, right. And as we watch this bum disappearing over the edge of the dam wall. Goodbye, Oxpecker. Goodbye, Mr. Hippo. I hope you have a lovely day. Let's go back to Karula, who's made an appearance again.
Well, she has made an appearance, everybody, but she's made it with only one cub, and it's the male who we knew was okay. Now, I don't think that's to say that she hasn't, that the female is in trouble. So that's little Hosanna. And I just think she doesn't know where Shongile is. She's calling still. So she's got one of them in tow, and she wouldn't, you know what? You know what's happened here, I think? She wouldn't have taken him to go and find the other one. So once she found one, she would have come back here, and she might dump him here and then go looking for her. That could easily happen. So I think it's definitely much too soon to worry about Shongile at this stage. And so he's going to have a bit of well-deserved meal after his horrible shock this morning. Interesting to see now if she goes off straight away. No, she's going to have a bit of a rest. So this is quite strange. Or maybe it isn't, I don't know. The more you postulate about these things, the more nonsense you tend to talk. Hello, Faith. What a nice question from you, and it's the opposite of what you'll think. You said when I first started doing this job, was it difficult for me not to try and help the animals or not to want to help the animals? No, it wasn't, because I came from a science-based background, and so I was very kind of, well, I was religious about science, if you like. I've modified my views a lot more now, and I mean, I've seen the obvious emotions that animals have, and I, in turn, feel a lot more emotional about the animals that we see out here. And so my inclination to interfere, although I would still fight that inclination, I must confess to you, so my inclination to interfere sometimes would be quite strong, but I would still fight it. So it's actually, it's harder for me now to detach myself emotionally than it's ever been. She's still looking off in that direction. So I wonder where little Shongile is. Hopefully by this afternoon she would have appeared. But what I think we'll do, let's sit here let me just check how much time we left. Okay, in fact, let's quickly head back to Taylor. She's got something really interesting to show you.
It's our friend, the hippo. He's Limpy the hippopotamus today. He's come out of the water. And we've got some zebra who are very uncertain of this hippo and are doing a wide berth around the hippo. And hopefully they're going to come to the pan. There they are. Now you can see the hippo is limping slightly. I'm not sure what, I didn't see any obvious injuries, so perhaps it's something internal, maybe he's a bit stiff, maybe he's got arthritis, I'm not 100% certain, but there he's disappearing. But I'm sure he'll be alright. When the adrenaline kicks in, you won't believe how amazing that is. Look at me, I outrun a buffalo that was very close to me as I dived into the tent, so I got some superpowers from those adrenaline. And here come the zebra, who are doing a little trot towards us. They're parading for us. Are you going to come and drink? That would be very nice. I think they're going to come to the little pan below the main dam and have a little drink, but they've spotted us and they're sussing us out, making sure that we're not lions or anything. waiting patiently at the water for them to come through. This looks a little bit like what I would imagine a tosha to look like, with the sand and the fallen trees and then this one little pan. I've never been, so I'm only speculating. But it'll be nice. Lovely zebras coming towards us. But note how they are very cautious. Now, I say this jokingly when I say that they look at us as if we were lions. But when you come to the seasons when there isn't a lot of rain around and the dams seem to be a little bit drier than normal, it's actually very, very common to see something like a leopard or a lion, even a cheetah, just scouting and hanging around a permanent water source or an area that there is water and actually just wait for their food to come to them. Now we can see this is the stallion, and you can see he's up in front, which is quite typical. And normally the stallion takes the lead when they do approach the water to suss out. Right, let's go to Steph very quickly for a fluffy feather and we'll hang around. A fluffy feather, a fluffy bird, and we'll hang around with the zebras.
This happens to be the longest chin spot batter sighting I've ever had. But just have a look at this. Little bird is about 4 yards or so away from us at the moment, sitting in a tree and just giving us the absolute best sighting. Of note with the chin spot batis is that chest bar and then those beautiful eyes. Just have a look at that. Oh, amazing. Now that long sharp bill used to pluck insects out of the air, but generally to glean insects from the branches that it lives in. So they'll flit, a male and a female in a pair, or flit from tree to tree, and will go through the leaf litter due to their small size and pick insects off very, very carefully and very thoroughly. I've watched some of these birds feed before, and the amount of insects that they can actually see and spot is just incredible. I envy them that. But just have a look at this. David doing a fantastic job keeping this camera literally dead still. And just giving you all those chances to get those screen grabs of these rare little birds. Obviously, they're not that rare, they're quite common, but because summertime hides the activities behind leaf foliage, these dry season views of them are just absolutely superb. And I must say, I mean, now we're probably into our third or fourth minute of watching this little bird. I don't quite know what he's doing. He might actually just be presenting himself to a female that's in the area. Or he's just busy watching us, watching him. That is fantastic. And one stick just in the way. Of course, it wouldn't be a walk if there wasn't a stick in the way. Now, the males and the females are quite different from one another. Although they all have the general size and shape of each other, the female, I can't actually remember now off the top of my head which one is the brownish chest band. I think it's the female with the browny chest band, but the male with a more solid color. I could be mistaken. It could be the other way around quite easily. But all of them with that beautiful white eye. Oh, yellow eye, in actual fact. In that black face. Giving me a decent enough time to actually look at the claw structure as well of this particular bird. Now, I see that their back claw is relatively elongated. I've never noticed that with the batises before. They're obviously a perching bird, which means they have 3 toes forward and 1 toe facing backwards. And that long back toe allows them to grip slightly wider branches. And I would imagine that that would be a help for them on larger diameter branches and help them to hold on to larger diameter branches, effectively increasing their feeding range. Can't think of another use for that. Feeding in trees also gives them access to spider webs. Now, Fran, you've just said that this is bird number 97 on your bird list. Congratulations, Fran. Wow, 97 is noteworthy, I'll be honest with you, and Chinspot Battis is definitely one of those that you need on your list. So congratulations, well done. Now these birds gleaning insects from the trees that they have access to spider webs, and it's the spider webs and the lichen that they build their nests out of. They do these most delightful cup-shaped nests. And quite often, yeah, absolutely. Sherry, all the way from California, has just asked me to repeat this name. Sherry, it's the Chinspot Battis. B-A-T-I-S and chin hyphen spot. Chinspot Battis, as opposed to the Cape Battis, which we also find in the country, but this is the only Battis that we find here. And I must be honest with you, a better sighting you are unlikely to have in years and years. This is the longest Chinspot Battis sighting I have ever had in 17 years of doing these safaris every day. Well, nearly every day, not quite every day, but nearly every day. And David just doing a superb job. He's got his camera, which is essentially handheld at head level. Just trying to keep it nice and still there, giving us this view of this usually quite fast flying bird. It's just awesome. But it has come to that time of the day where we get to say goodbye to you for now. And at least from myself and Dave, I just want to say thank you for joining us on the bushwalk today. Thank you as always for your questions and your comments. I'm going to send you through to Taylor and that hippo.
We're watching a couple of vultures. There were a few, well, Mr. and Mrs. Wahlberg were also joining in. But this looks like a white-backed vulture that we can see soaring around. Now, like I said, there were a couple of them, and they were trying to catch a thermal. And I think it's going to be quite difficult for them today to try and catch a decent thermal. You can see lots of wing flapping going on over there. And normally they will find a stream of hot air and catch it, and then they sort of start to circle, and then occasionally you get a tornado of vultures, what looks like a tornado that's going around, and the vultures just circling, going round and round and round. And I know that we have got a couple of new viewers today, so if you're wondering if you ever see a vulture circling, if that means that that's a kill, not necessarily, because when they catch those thermals, they do have to do the circular motions, and often people will get confused. Now, they are obviously struggling quite a bit today. I don't think there's any thermal right there, unfortunately. They can reach quite a few thousand meters up into the sky. It's quite special. We're going to go carry on along this road over here, and I'm hoping we're going to bump back into maybe the elephants, maybe Mr. Hippo in the drainage line, perhaps those zebra again. They zooted off. Something gave them a bit of a fright, and they ran away. So maybe we'll catch up with them as well. Now, I haven't been seeing too many vultures around in terms of sort of catching up all the thermals. That's something that I'd love to be able to see and to be able to show you live, is quite a few of them though. So not just one or two desperately trying to catch a thermal, but maybe 50 or 60, maybe even 100. Imagine seeing 100 vulture in the sky sort of twirling around. It's quite special. It's really beautiful to see. But I think we're going to have to wait for sunnier and warmer days to come through before we can hope to really see anything like that. Now we're going to have a careful look here, because this is exactly where our hippopotamus entered, into this Tamboti thickened drainage line. So we're going to do a little see. Oh, there he is. Oh, I'm so sorry, Mr. Hippopotamus. I hope my brakes didn't wake you. But he has now found a lovely spot under the shade of a gwari. So like I said, it is overcast and cloudy, so it's not too bad. And he's decided to take a rest. I think that watering hole is going to be quite busy, and he doesn't want to be disturbed anymore. So he's come to have a little siesta out here, which is lovely. And you can see him fast asleep now. I thought that perhaps he was going to get out and maybe go for a bit of a graze and take advantage of, like I said, of this lovely cool weather. Normally we're only seeing the hippos grazing at night, because they've got a very thin, sensitive skin, and they need to obviously keep nice and cool. Oh, hello, James Richard. So as you heard, James Kirsty was just talking about you now. So James Richin would like to know, with the hippos not having as long and dense sort of set of eyelashes like perhaps the other animals, how do they protect themselves? Now, something with the hippos you must remember is that we don't normally see them moving through thick vegetation all the time. And the food that they are really feeding on is grass. So they don't have to worry, like elephants, perhaps like impala, like giraffe, of getting any foreign objects. So sort of any thorns in their eyes, they normally have got quite a thick layer because they're not reaching into any trees. So I don't think there's really any need. And they spend most of their time in the water and actually submerged. So possibly there just isn't really too much of a need for them. Unfortunately, I wish I could actually show you his eyelashes because that would have been quite nice to see, but he's just lying in a bit of an awkward spot. But it'd be quite interesting to find out a little bit more about that. But unfortunately, it's come to that time of the day where I'm going to have to say a farewell to you, but I hope you enjoyed this morning and I hope to see you all again soon, and I'm sure I'll see you a little bit later this afternoon. So from myself and Jandre, have a wonderful day.
You thought that you'd seen the last of Steph? Well, you haven't. He's just up ahead, everybody. But that is not the point of what I really want to say. That is that we left Karula. We went to see if we could see Shongile, perhaps in one of the trees around about where they were chased. We didn't see anything there, and so we left. They, I'm pretty sure, are going to be there this afternoon, and no doubt Brent or Jamie will go have a look at them this afternoon and see if they can't find what's happening there. I'm pretty sure she's going to leave Hosana to eat, and she'll go off and see if she can find Shongile. Now, of course, you've seen Steph today quite a lot, but you have not seen David. Hello, David.
Hello, Jay.
There is David, everybody. And there is the great and inimitable Herbert Causer. Herbert, of course, is very well camouflaged, as you can see. David is dressed, I'm not sure what David's dressed like. Anyway, the less said about that, the better. Okay, we will see you back for breakfast shortly. Bye. Goodbye, everybody. David does have camouflage pants on, I suppose. Now you are asking what my one word was to describe this drive. You know what? I found it quite harrowing. It was, I just, like I said, I don't feel kind of that yay feeling that you get after you've watched a lion kill or something like that. I just feel harrowed by it. Why we attach ourselves emotionally so much more to cats than we do to impala. So as Viem was saying to me, it's no problem watching a buffalo being killed. Yes, it's harrowing, and it's not harrowing. There are lots of emotions, but you come out of it thinking, wow, that was amazing. You come out of watching what I saw today feeling, well, not traumatized, but I mean, there's an element of feeling slightly traumatized by it. Viem, what will you say? One word to describe?
I was thinking toiling.
Toiling?
It was hard work.
It was hard work, he says. And that's because, I mean, I guess to spot what we spotted was difficult. And it was difficult to see what was going on. There were baboons running everywhere, trees everywhere, leopards running all over the place. Then there was the hyena. So, yeah, I'm going to go with harrowing. Certainly from an emotional point of view, it was quite harrowing. So thank you all for watching it with us. And then I know Jason, for example, said he had to turn off. He couldn't watch it. He was having a heart attack at the time. And I quite understand that particular perspective. All right, everybody, that's going to be it from us today. A big thank you to all of you for coming along on the ride. What a drive it was, and kahumas and leopards and baboons, and the rather harrowing experience of watching those baboons chasing the leopards. So thanks for coming and commenting and sharing it with us. Big thank you to Viem on camera today. Thank you, Viem. Well done. Good job. And of course to David and Steph and Herbert and Jandre and Taylor. We'll see you this afternoon at 3:30. Bye-bye.